Well, hello everyone who's joined us this evening for the latest iteration of Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families. Good to not see all of you, but see you on the participation page. I'm really glad to co-host this. I'm Roy Yankee with PIR Ministries, and this has been a collaborative effort between the Office of General Assembly, the EPC, and PIR Ministries. So it's great to be with you this evening. One comment I will make right away before I introduce my co-host, and that is that a little later on, we're going to open up to questions and answers. And down at the bottom of your Zoom page, there's a Q&A icon, and there you can click on that and put your questions in when that time becomes appropriate. And so without further ado, let me introduce my co-host and good friend, Annie Rose, Director of Ministerial Support and Development for the EPC. Annie, good evening.
Good evening, Roy. Thank you so much for that introduction. Brothers and sisters, as always, it's wonderful to be here with you, bringing you content to help you stay focused on being healthy and growing as a disciple of Jesus. Whether you are a pastor yourself or you're married to a pastor in the EPC, we want this to be a denomination where we are all growing and thriving as we stay connected to Jesus, the true vine. So we are very blessed tonight to have with us Gail Goolsby, who I will introduce here in just a moment. Gail is just a wonderful wealth of wisdom and experience, and I'm looking forward to what she's going to share with us tonight on the topic of navigating transition in life and ministry. Gail has a really interesting background as a teacher, a counselor, a coach, a speaker, and a writer. She's going to tell us a little bit more about that background. But Gail, thank you once again for joining us tonight. We're really looking forward to what you have to share with us on the topic of navigating transition. Why don't you tell us a little bit more about yourself and the work that you do?
Okay. Thank you, Annie. And Roy, it's good to be with friends. It's so comfortable. Sorry, we're not together in person, but we're together. Yes, I'm a career educator. I thought at one time my dream was to be a kindergarten teacher forever. I love five-year-olds. They just are so sparkly with curiosity and everything's new and they love you every day. But eventually I moved into administration and a master's in counseling from Liberty. And so that began to just kind of expand my horizon of the branches of the education tree. And so then I was asked to become the principal of the international school in Kabul, Afghanistan back in 2005. And that's not anything I ever wanted to do, but it was pretty clear that God somehow was putting all the pieces together to trust him and go for it. So my husband and I went there for 7 years. And the International School of Kabul, which then closed not quite 10 years later due to security issues, was my unbelievable adventure for 7 years. So when I came back from that, I never wanted to be a principal again because it's hard and it's worthy, but there's something about that that brings out the lion side in me that I really don't feel like I want to just live with every day. So I came back and entered into a two-year transition, trying to figure out the next part of life. And I was introduced to coaching at that time through some debriefing that I engaged in to kind of figure out what happened in those 7 years. And I went to the training. My local church in Missouri paid for that. It was a great gift. And so I learned about it thinking, oh, just another piece of counseling, but no, way different. And I loved it. And so in 2013, I embarked on coaching as a work to do, as my husband then pursued another position in pastoral ministry, and then eventually moved to Wichita, Kansas, which is where we are now. And he is the congregational care pastor, associate pastor at Eastminster. He's also was 4 years the missions pastor there. So we've been here a long time for us, it seems like. And I've done a lot of different kinds of coaching with ministries, but I really, really like working with fellow believers. And as a Christian coach, I feel like we have such a place where we can help them just uncover that wonderful story that God promised he wrote before we had one day on the earth and begin to turn the next page. Sometimes when they feel like the pages are blank and the writing is invisible, and they just need someone to help ask the questions and help them to make some plans and targets that will keep them moving forward while they're really not sure what the next the next label, the next identity really happens to be. So I've worked with Global Ministry with Thrive, helped them set up coaching for global women workers, and that's been great. I also work with BetterUp, which is a corporate coaching situation, and that's a whole different piece of it, but it's still amazing. No matter if you're a senior legal counsel with Chevron or you are someone who's just coming back after being in China for 20 years, we are people. And we are people who really don't do well with the fuzziness of the unknown, which is what transition is all about. Mm-hmm. So I'm a grandma and a pastor's wife, and I love all those pieces. And I really enjoy working with, we are a resettlement city in Wichita. So I'm in my like second layer of Afghan involvement with our 1,200 refugees that we have here in Wichita. And so I have I'm in my second friendship with an Afghan woman who was there in the 20 years of unhindered education in Afghanistan history. And boy, can she work her devices, and she knows how to read English and she can learn. And it makes so much difference. Just reminds me of the value of education. So I think of coaching as another branch of education tree. So I think I'm still in my wheelhouse, even though it's not a classroom setting or even in a school. It's just helping people learn to live well, which is kind of my tagline and what I call my own business, because I feel like we've got this great life and God wants us to enjoy it. But sometimes we need help learning to live it well, or else we find all the negatives and we miss a lot of the other things that are coming our way.
Excellent. Wow. So we're talking about navigating transitions tonight, and coaching around that is a big deal, I'm sure.
Big deal.
Yeah. So what are some of the transitions that pastors and their spouses face as they go through their ministry life and hit those challenges, those doors that open or close? What are those kinds of situations that you have found and have helped coach around?
So when I was thinking about that question, I thought, well, in some ways, we're like people in a lot of different career choices, but then we are actually very special. And so as I've worked with mostly pastors' wives, but some pastors too, sometimes it becomes a transition because your denomination wants you to not stay in the same church family for a long time, and they want you to keep uprooting. And so you have a little bit what I would call the military mindset, which is, we ain't going to be here long, so everybody kind of go deep. And then they kind of stall out. It's a little bit of the third culture kids and military kids thing. People who have a transitions a lot, they go in deep because they need relationships. And sometimes they stall out because they know I'm leaving, or you're leaving, somebody's leaving. And it's almost like they guard their heart a little bit so that they don't have that deep pain of loss. And I think pastors can be in that same, but they may not move to a different military base, but they can have that if they are, you know, looking for or forced or choose to have a different place of service. So I think there's that. And how do you then move your nest as a female, particularly? I think that word is a pastor's wife. We have to build the nest, and the next nest, put the sticks in. We find the school for our kids. We find the friends that we left behind. We find where we're going to get our teeth work done and a doctor, and all these things that come into now making this a place where we're known. And we know we don't have to look at GPS every time we're finding the grocery store. We don't have to, you know, do those things that actually take out a lot of energy when you're always introducing yourself or having to think it. I mean, right now you could probably get to your local grocery store and think about four of the things and just get there, because it's a little autopilot. It's known, it's familiar. But in transition, when it's unknown, it takes a lot of energy to figure it out. And I think pastors, especially if they have been in a place a long time, that's a certain kind of transition. But if they're constantly uprooting, that's different too.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So are there any particular stories, without, you know, sharing anything that you shouldn't, that you've run into along those lines?
Well, in some of the groups that I've had a chance to meet with other pastors' wives, it's an interesting thing, and this is our story. So when we came here, we came as empty nesters. So when you have kids, there's these like built-in little connecting points, you know, sports teams and school activities and play, you know, friends they want to meet, and then you meet the parents. There's these like built-in connectors. When you don't have that, you have to initiate. And that's, again, it takes out of you. And so some people who struggle with that and have not, we all want to be invited, but let's face it, when you're the new person, if you really wait to always be invited, you could be waiting a long time. I think coming here to Wichita, I just decide, you know what? I'm going to be smiling. I'm going to be asking good questions. I'm going to be inviting people to, I'm going to do my part to initiate. And I found some really great women to connect with, but guess what? They had friends. They were full, their kids were in town. So that was very nice, but it wasn't going to be regular or, you know, intimate. And so I think that's an interesting time too. But for also, as I've talked with young moms, and especially those who are full-time at home, can be really lonely. Nobody's calling you. Nobody's checking on you, or at least not in your neighborhood. And so again, it's like getting that kid in the stroller and going down to the park. It's joining a mom's group or a Bible study. Even when you're tired, you don't feel like it, you just need to show up in those things. So I'm not an extrovert on the Myers-Briggs in the way that some people are, like my husband who wants to know every new person in the world, but I'm not afraid to do that. But that, you know, that really has to come from within. And also with the idea that, you know what, if this one doesn't work, kick off the dust and try somebody else. There's going to be somebody who's looking for a friend just like you are. So I call transition the nowhere between two somewheres. This came from actually a business book about transitions. And he was talking about how we have an identity and we're going to have another one. But right now we're in no man's land. We don't know if someone comes up to us and says, what do? You're like, I don't know yet. Or, well, I have this new job and I'm still figuring it out. Or, you know, if you're a full-time mom, maybe you're looking for part-time work. There's just things you don't have an answer to that, but you will. So that's kind of that unknown. And you, a lot of people are hard on themselves. I think one of you mentioned earlier before we got on the air about trying to speed through that. But in truth, that can really short circuit what I think God is doing, which sometimes is actually giving you less people calling you because of the energy to build the nest or to learn a new job. You need to have some storage built up, some resilience. And so not having everybody know you and want you actually, I think, is a good piece of transition. I call it kind of that little, nobody knows I'm here yet. So nobody's expecting me. So I can really do some things I need to do at home. So I'm ready to launch from here. And my haven is ready while my husband might be learning a new job or vice versa. So I think there's a lot that can be looked at transition in a positive way. If we're patient and we believe that the Lord brought us here and he knows the future. So it's not really a surprise to him. And we just need to navigate slowly with the next step, which, as Roy knows, is a huge coaching. It makes your lights blink when people say, I just need to know the next. Wow, let's do that. That's great. And coaching is a great way to help people navigate transitions. Yeah.
So do you feel like with all of the pieces of a transition that the emotional side of things kind of gets overlooked, and everything you've just been talking about in terms of figuring out all that and using that space wisely during that time, that's not something people normally think about?
And one of the big things about transition is when you're leaving, you have feelings about that. Now, grief and loss. We had I remember our Christian school that our kids grew up in was in a 30-year-old building. It was just a small elementary school. It was all they could afford when they started the Christian school. And then little by little, we were moving into this brand new spanking school. And they were trying to get things done so that this one graduating class that was, they thought it could be for them to move to the new school and go, and they refused. They had like a sit-in. It was crazy. They're like, we don't want to go to that place. It's nothing to us.
Wow.
And so when it looked like they were going to have to, I mean, I was over the student council at the time as the school counselor, and I'm sitting here going, you don't want to be in the air conditioned, beautiful school after this place has nothing and we're hot. So, and they said, well, if we do that, we want to take part of the basketball floor with us. Now, we're in an elementary school. Our basketball court was so small. The boundaries were at the corner. I mean, you had to go up the wall. I mean, it was so tiny, but it was just their identity. And so they were like, if we have to go, we want to take something with us. And so in that business book on transition, he was encouraging managers and leaders to say, you know, if people want to cry and meet together and talk about what they're going to miss, let them. That's part of the moving forward, is the grieving out what you're losing. And the fact that you loved that and you were fully ingrained there is not a bad thing. It shows what kind of loyal worker you are. And so I think when people in transition, there is emotion. And I think they should keep talking to their friends and say they miss them, instead of just this full force, you know, face forward and full speed ahead. And what? Just pretend like that never happened, which is now part of who I am. So yes, part of, I think, that dip in the transition needs to be some actual missing and crying and thinking, saying together, oh, kids, remember when we used to do every Sunday after church, we'd go to lunch with these folks. That was so fun. I hope we'll find a new family to have lunch with. But the grieving is there. And then hoping that hope will move in to what is possible and what is coming. And it's a crisis. It's a crisis, really. And we need to not act like you should be good about it. In the business book, one of the things he said was that top leaders who've been talking about this transition for a long time, when they first bring it out and they're all, you know, sparkly, they get really bummed out when the people are like, what? You mean I'm going to have to drive across town? What if I don't like what? That's going to, you know, they just start complaining and they get mad about it. But they've been thinking about it for months. And these people are like hit in the face with this new thing. That's something I think is not, we need to be gentle with ourselves and with people going through transition, because they are in shock. They don't know exactly what they want or don't want. They're just in shock. And I think that having someone to walk with them and say, hey, this is normal. Yeah, you're going to feel that way for a while, I think, you know, gives them permission to feel some of those things.
Absolutely. Yeah. Anytime we're going through transition, it brings up so much emotion. And it might not only be related to that actual transition, but it may call up experiences we've had in the past that maybe we didn't have the capacity to really grieve. And so we kind of have that compounding effect. It can just be a very complicated thing. Speaking of all that emotion that's involved, we had a question come in about guilt. Someone asked, what do you advise to do with the guilt of leaving behind, you know, leaving behind your church, leaving behind friendships, whatever it may be? Sometimes there is that sense of guilt, especially if it's a transition that we've chosen, that we've had a hand in crafting. There can be that sense of guilt about those who are left behind. What would you coach someone to do, how to work through that emotion?
Well, guilt is definitely a downer. And so it's always worth exploring. Is it false guilt? Is it really something that I have caused that I need to own or fix? But sometimes it's just really sadness and wishing I wasn't making someone else sad. And I think, how many of us in the world, in the Christian world, have been left or left somebody? I mean, it happens. We've probably been on both sides of that. But for me, I will tell you, and I'm not a big guilt person, but my husband, their family has tickets to the guilt train all the time. And so when we were getting ready to go to Afghanistan, our kids were semi-launched. And my husband is like, got the call, and you just feel strongly, we're going to sell the houses, like, you know, burn the bridges, we're going. And I'm like, I signed a 2-year contract. I don't know about this. Like, we're never coming back kind of view. And I had these kids, like one just got married. One was still in college. One was trying to find between. I'm like, I'm putting them on the street with a suitcase. What am I doing here? Well, my heart was heavy with that. And my husband's just like, you know, they're 19, 20 years old. I'm like, huh. So God answered my prayer, and that some people from our church offered to pay our house payment for 2 years. And we didn't have a big house, but it was that. And it's so, on so many levels, it was a tremendous gift from God to me personally. But all that to say, living over there, like, you know, usually your kids leave you, but they love to say, yeah, you left us. So we went to Afghanistan without them.
Yeah.
And then, so we're there like in 6 months, 5 months of the time we're there, my two youngest, the oldest was married, had breakups with 4 and 6 year relationships. Talk about feeling bad. I'm like, I should be there. This is painful. These are Christian kids trying to do well, but this is painful. They probably thought they were going to end up together forever with these long-term relationships. Mm-hmm. So all that to say, I get that part of it, but all I know is that when we are called to stretch a relationship, to move further away than we have wanted, God is at work. And sometimes, I mean, the things my kids grew in while the time we were apart, I would never have guessed. And I was so proud. To this day, I'm proud. But they navigated some things. I mean, we called on the phone and stuff, but you know, you can't be there 24/7. And there were things they learned about each other as siblings that they really just kind of found, you know, formed this, we're all left and we need each other, which still sounds terrible. But anyway, my point is that sometimes when we leave a relationship, things will happen that we can then recognize, wow, I got to see something really good and exciting. So I think the thing to do is acknowledge the sadness. I think we should grieve. I think we should express ourselves to a trusted person. And then just really believe that God has a plan for them in your leaving, as well as for you and your going. I mean, otherwise he's small, right? And we know he's not small. He's big. So I've incurred the wrath of those who felt I left them. And and I still look at that and think, oh wow, that was hard, but I wouldn't trade it. I don't know. That sounds maybe too easy, doesn't it? I don't mean it to sound easy. It's complicated.
It's a process, but it's beautiful. It's encouraging for those of us in the midst of it to hear these testimonies of how God was faithful through it. And just, I liked your phrase, stretching a relationship too. Yeah. That's a really good way to put it. It's not breaking, it's stretching. I like that.
Yeah, that's really good. You've talked a lot about some of the challenges of transitions already, and in particular, you mentioned the military model or experience of multiple changes. It is interesting, I think, that as we move forward in the EPC, we're starting to see a lot more transitional pastors who are stepping into new situations, sometimes pretty regularly. So do you have any thoughts or advice on that?
We have one right now at Eastminster, a transitional pastor.
Yeah. And sometimes it involves a geographical move. Sometimes it may not.
Yeah.
So, you know, what thoughts do you have along those lines?
Well, with that title in there, of course, my little antenna was kind of blinking about all that. And I've enjoyed conversation with our transitional pastor. And I think one of the things, and I didn't mention this before, but we talked about things pastors go through, and we experienced for the first time sabbatical transitions where a pastor, you know, took some time off, was gifted by the church, maybe a month, maybe more, and how we all worked through that. And again, it was kind of like this blank page, and everybody began to think, now let's look at this, because, you know, it kind of stopped the, here's what we, just the everyday rhythms are now kind of changing, and everyone's kind of got a little bit of a different perspective. The sabbatical pastor has a different perspective, the people in leadership. And that can be very interesting, because we want to believe that transitions are going to be, they're going to come out on this side. We're going to be stronger. We're going to have reflection time. We're going to have, you know, all these things, and we're going to come out. But sometimes what happens in transition is God finally gets your attention, because things have kind of moved to a standstill or slowed down, and he gives you a different vision, a different call, or something that maybe was filtering in your mind, but you were just doing the thing. And then all of a sudden now you have a chance to go, I really can't get over thinking that. I think I need to really check in with God about that, and that would cause a change. So I think a transitional pastor is great to come in when things are a little fuzzy and ask questions from an outsider's point of view to make people sharpen up. Well, what do I think about that? Well, now that we have a blank page, what do we want to write on that? And it really, those questions are valuable because we kind of get a little bit stuck in, well, this is what we've been doing and ain't nobody died from it. So why don't we just keep doing it that way? When really we're all changing, you know, the church itself is changing and millennial, I mean, all generations. So we need to really, and I know Roy and your, I just think questions are like magic when you can really get people to sit there and ask a well-formed question and they have to go, huh, I should think about that. I always think God's up there going, great, let's think about that. Let's talk about that. And it causes them to press into God in a new way that they may have, you know, get off autopilot and move into a possibilities are open now. So what are we going to do? That's good. It's scary though. I would just say that.
It is. And do you feel like, you mentioned with the military model of wanting to go deep, but then knowing that you can sometimes shut down. Are there some things that transitional pastors in particular should understand about their own transition into that role and then maybe out of that role in a short period of time that they need to kind of be aware of?
One thing I thought our pastor did really well was at the very beginning, he told everyone in different ways, kindly and very positively saying what his role was, and that he was going to be spending the majority of his time with staff and with the session. And I can't wait to get to know some of you as we can, but understand I won't be able to do it the way, you know, a full-time pastor would do, because that's not my job. I need to try to help get things very well as best we can in place for your next senior pastor to come. So he was really, really good at explaining that. But he, you know, he took any dinner invitations. I mean, he met lots of people and enjoyed that, and very winsome in the hallway. I mean, it wasn't like he was saying, I can't talk to you, you're just a congregant. It wasn't like that, but he just kind of made it clear that if I don't get to do everything that you would wish I would be doing or attend every event, it's because I have these priorities. So I thought that was really helpful. And this is their fourth, I think. And I have talked with his wife about it and talked with them. And they, one of the things that they are doing is making trips. They're intentional with planning trips to their family, to their kids, their grandkids, whatever. They're not just saying, well, we're going to be in Wichita or whatever, and we'll see you when we see you. They're keeping their own relationships that are important to them going, because I'm not saying he said this, but I'm guessing, because, you know, this is short term. I can't just take 2 years out of my relationship with my, you know, my mother or, you know, whatever, that kind of stuff. So I think that's really wise. And so I think transitions in churches can be really hard, especially if people are just visiting. And so pastors feel a lot of responsibility about how to leave things in good stead, but sometimes they don't really get that option if they're, you know, asked to leave or don't have a way to kind of just leave well, you know, build the raft, as we say it when we were, you know, overseas, where you do all these different steps to leave well. Sometimes you don't have a chance to do that. And that is kind of where some of the guilt and the sadness can come in, because there were people you didn't get to say goodbye to. Our current, but just now transitioning out missions pastor, they went on vacation during COVID and never got to go back to their place in China to say goodbye. That's hard. And so that can happen sometimes, but but there's still ways to try to, I feel like if we'll just allow people to not feel like, oh, you've got to be moving forward and act like there's nothing at all happening inside of you, I think we don't give a good model to the people in our congregation who are experiencing transition and widowhood and, you know, not being able to have a baby or divorce. Everybody's having that. And to have a leader that shows I'm a person too, and this has been hard, I think that's really good leadership. I think that's that vulnerability gives them permission to say, well, you get me then. You know, instead of feeling like, oh, I'm a strong Christian, where's your faith? Well, still there. But, you know, there's lots of scriptures about, you know, what God talks to us about, how he doesn't expect us when we're mourning to show up dancing, but it will come. He doesn't expect us to just pretend like we're not mourning. I mean, there's lots of things about that. So, yeah, I think if we don't give our emotions airspace, they're going to get stuck in a box and the lid's going to fly off at an inopportune moment when you didn't want to be that person. And there you are.
Yeah, so
that's true. Right. That's right. It'll come out sideways one way or the other. Well, along those lines, Gail, we had a good question come in regarding pastors' families, specifically the children in cases of forced terminations. And, you know, some of our folks have had that experience. It's incredibly painful. We know, Roy, your ministry at PIR, that was how you all started off, ministering to pastors who had experienced a forced exit and all the wounding that comes along with that. And so the question from one of our viewers was, in that case of a forced termination, how do you help your kids to not be so angry? Angry at God, angry at the church that you've been forced to leave, or angry at the parents for moving? What guidance would you give to a parent helping their children navigate those strong emotions in a forced exit?
Well, Roy, you're welcome to take some time with us too. Since I mean, I have had some of those conversations, but I probably haven't had them to the level that Roy has. But in dealing with children as an early childhood educator and all that, and I'm watching my daughters, their kids are everywhere from 3 to up to 15. There's just a lot more permission now to let kids say things. And I think back, sadly, in our day, we were a little bit of, it wasn't that you couldn't feel that way, but it was a little bit like, okay, you said that, now let's go. I mean, it wasn't quite the sitting with it that I feel like the parents are doing now. And I applaud them for that. I feel like giving kids permission to say, I'm just so mad about that, without feeling like you have to say or own all of it and say, me too sometimes. And following God is not, you know, Jesus never made it pretty clear, it's going to be a knife in your heart. You know, you're going to be saying goodbye to parents, and there's just going to be some hard things following Christ. So I think doing that, I remember when we changed churches one time, our oldest was like just starting in her youth group, and it was a big blow up. I mean, that church doesn't even exist anymore. It was awful. And so we're telling her that we're going to another church in town. And she told us, I'm walking back to my youth group. You can't make me go to that new youth group. And we're like, wow. I mean, she just was so, you know, her friends were there, and woo, we didn't know what to do. And so we said, okay, but we couldn't really have her go back to that youth group. I mean, things had just been that acrimonious. So we said, okay, well, we're just going to ask you to try it. And if you decide you don't want to, we understand. Well, in the meantime, my husband was a pastor on staff. There were 6 pastors on staff, and 2 of them had girls our daughter's age. And so he went to them and said, hey, I heard they're having a youth missions dinner. I mean, this was a big missions-minded church. And would your girls reach out to our daughter when they see her at church and just say, come sit with us? Because we knew she wouldn't look at them and say, no, I'm not going to say it, because she was just a little bit too perfect for that. Anyway, so she said, okay. And she came home and told us, this so-and-so and so-and-so asked me to come to the missions dinner. And I said, oh, do you feel like you can do that? Well, I'm not going to like it. Or she said something like that. I'm like, okay, you know, fine. She loved it, because they were going on a trip to Lithuania. I mean, this church, the youth didn't go to Mexico. They went to Belarus and Cambodia. I mean, they were all about spiritual work. It captured her. And those girls didn't become like her best friends, but it just took somebody to just be with her. So I just look for God in those circumstances, because we were sad too, but we didn't want our kids to be feeling like they had nothing to offer them. And she looks back at that now and she'll say, I remember feeling so mad about that, but God had something so much bigger for me. I would never have known They had their own worship band, and she became one of the lead vocalists in this because the youth pastor was an ex-rocker. He'd just throw these kids in a band, and they were all over the city. People knew him, and she's a worship leader. All our kids are worship leaders because of that. So I like that we could look back with them and do that. But at the time, I mean, they would say that too. We didn't, it wasn't our choice for you to go to Afghanistan. We didn't want you to do that. And our daughter did say to us, you left us at a time when I was mad at you, but she has said those things. So you have to have big shoulders and adults, and you do the best you can to say, you know, your dad and I, or your mom and I, are just trying to figure out how to follow God the best we can. And you're with us. We're a package deal. But I've known lots of overseas workers whose kids have really struggled with their faith when they came back because they never wanted to be where their parents were. We had them in our school. It was hard.
Well, and I think what you said about making the space for the kids to verbalize those things that are really hard for us to hear as parents, you know, you never want to be the cause of your child's pain. You never want to be in the bullseye of their anger, especially for those of us in ministry who are pouring ourselves into other people's lives to disciple them. The thought that our kids could be angry at God because of something, you know, that happened in our ministry, like, it's just horrifying to think about. And yet it is so important to create that opportunity for them to be honest and for us to meet them with that honesty. I loved what you said, Gail, about saying, yeah, I'm sad too. I miss them too. Letting them know that they're not alone in that grief and in that anger. I think that's really, really good.
Do you think too, so I'm just going to ask this, your wisdom on this, that is it unhelpful or helpful if the parents have a conversation, especially with older kids, about, you know, without painting a dark picture, you know, just some of the realities of what following Jesus is like, and, you know, church isn't perfect, and these things do happen. Do you think that can be helpful to just really talk about that?
My view, and I know it's not everyone's view, and it's uncomfortable for a lot of people. I was just talking about this with my younger daughter. She's here visiting right now, and on a certain issue. And I said, I grew up in a home where you could talk about anything. My dad was a strong personality. I am my father's daughter. And he never left the throne. Now, you were going to do what he said, but you could talk about it. He would be like, what do you got for me? What's your question? I think that whether it's about, you know, body, child safety or sexual, I think the message that parents, Christian parents, should not be afraid to say to their kids is, we can talk about anything, and we want you to bring it here, but, you know, because your friends are got some of the same questions you do. So it's a little blind leading the blind, but let's talk about it together. What are your questions? Because the beauty about, you know, whether it's a little kid asking about where babies come from, generally their questions tell you where they're at with what they are able to understand. So for example, now it's kind of fun having kids in their 30s and 40s because you can kind of go back and say, so what happened to that? What's your takeaway from that? And I've heard my kids say, because all my kids are still following the Lord, involved in churches. I have a son-in-law who's a pastor in college. And this is what I hear them say. You and dad let us know that the church was not perfect and there were going to be people that were going to hurt, and it was going to be the hardest hurt you ever had because you just didn't think that it would happen in the church. But when it's working, it's the best place on earth. And so they saw small groups who helped us move. They saw people who brought meals when we had a baby. They saw good parts of the church in action, and we identified that, and we did those things too. So, hello, we were, I've had some really bad burns with pastors, and my kids know it. But I didn't quit. I just said, oh my gosh, God put me here. I have value, and I'm just going to keep finding a place where it seems like it fits. And so that's what they did. And they've seen good leaving as well as the bad. When we moved from Missouri to Wichita, we had come back from overseas and we didn't have a clue. We had our little house. And, you know, we're just waiting. And so our church said, hey, we need an assistant to help the pastor while we're doing that. Mike, come on, you're blah, blah, blah. And that's how we learned about EPC, because they were switching and it was a great time. And they gave us enough that we could just live. And I'm at home just trying to figure out what was that last chapter of Afghanistan where I was fired and blah, blah, blah. And so they said, we can do this for a year, but then we're going to get our new senior pastor and we can't afford you. So we knew. So he's looking for a job. He's looking for a job, and he's in his upper 50s. So he's getting a lot of people saying, oh, we'd love to have you, but you're kind of like the age of the senior pastor we're trying to replace. Oh, it was hard. He got really, It was really a hard time for him and for me. And so I remember, though, finally the whole thing happened with Eastminster. It took them 9 months. I mean, I had friends who were like, people have babies in that period of time. You want to work with these people? What's the deal? But the new senior pastor was just coming. It made sense afterwards, but the time. So we're told December 28th is his last day. And he got the call November 27th. But they had this great. And there were people who wanted him to be the senior pastor there, but we felt that wasn't God's plan. So we got people already sitting here like this, like, if Pastor Mike doesn't have a job, we're going to be mad. So we're feeling a lot of pressure. And I'm sure the elders are too. Anyway, all that to say, it was a great leaving. They just pampered us and talked about us. And our kids all came to that. And they said, finally, a good leaving. This is what the church should be. So see what I'm saying? I think families need to just keep on telling the truth about we're broken people. We're figuring that out. I've hurt people. They've hurt us. Well, we're going to stay in this because this is God's plan for revealing who he is on earth. And so I don't know. I know it's hard. There's a lot of precious friends of mine whose kids are grown up in the church and now they're not choosing it. I do not say I have a formula. We're blessed, but I have heard those comments from them. We talked about it. We talked about it openly. Like when they said, well, why did that pastor, dad? And he'd be like, well, can't tell you everything about it, but this is what he's thinking. And I just can't agree with that. So I'm going to leave because he's, you know, whatever. So we tried to, as best we could, be honest with them. And they were mad. I mean, there was one pastor my son said, I have bad dreams about him. I want to hurt him because of what happened with dad. And I was like, oh, buddy,
yeah,
you're a sweet guy. That does not like you at all. But that's how badly he felt. He was a teenager and it just brought out that testosterone, you know, you hurt my dad, I'm going to hurt you kind of thing. But, you know, eventually I heard him say something about the day. Remember, Mom, I told you about him. Oh, yeah, I remember that. It was, you know, but
that made an impression. Yeah.
Yeah, because he just was an easygoing, you know, love dogs and kids kind of guy. He was not so I do think back to what we're saying, let kids know, let adults know, we can talk about it here and we're going to do it unto the Lord, not just to vent and wish them to go down a hole and, you know, I mean, I just say I've never asked God to do that vengeance part. I would be lying if I hadn't said that. But I basically say, your problem, I believe. I don't know how you're going to fix this, but I can't. I got things to do. I got to move on. Right? I mean.
Yeah.
That's right. Well, we had another question come in from one of our viewers, and this is kind of on a different tack. The question is, what might it mean if a pastor or their family would welcome a transition if they're ready for that or they feel like they're ready for something different? So, you know, someone who might be grappling a little bit with this stirring, with this feeling like it might be time for something new. What do we make of that? What words of guidance or what questions would you ask somebody as they sort through those feelings?
When we were considering seminary, we were at a CBN and we were with potential students and we met the head of the law school. It had just been sent over from ORU to Pat Robertson School. And we ended up at a table with him at one of the meal events. And we were like, how do we make this decision? We feel like God's been calling him for like 3 years. He wanted to be, you know, trained and study the word. He's got an agricultural bachelor's degree. And he said, here's what we do. And we've talked about this. He said, you know, the three persons of God speaks and is in different ways. And so we look for God, all circumstances, the father of creation and all that. We look for circumstances to start showing us something's coming or laying out how this could work. Then we look at the Son, the living word of God, and we look for scripture and we look for affirmation as we read together and as we memorize things and just let it speak to us. And then the Holy Spirit, which is mysterious, but sometimes there's just something you can't really explain about this, but it's just got your attention. And when those three things start to line up, there's a lot of confidence in that. And that is exactly what happened to us when we were getting ready to go to seminary. And we kind of used that, sounds like a formula, but just those senses of things to try to be open to that. And so Henry Blackaby says, if you feel stirred up, stay put the last place you knew God called you until he calls you somewhere else, which means you have to leave this place to get there, like Moses, which is, you know, the experiencing God Bible study is all about. And I think those are the things that we really need to do, because then come what may, when you go there, you're building on a rock, solid faith and evidence of God's talking to you. So, you know, that means you access wise counsel, you access people who know and love you, you even access people who may be someone you would think, I don't even know if I'm going to like what they have to say, but I really think they have a good, wise view of these kind of events. And, you know, your network comes together because God's just always talking. We're just not always listening. So if someone is really stirred and they feel like they have finished their call here, which is like what we felt like in Missouri, because they needed a senior pastor, but we felt like it wasn't us, then I think that's something to take into your prayer and your counsel time with others, and, you know, keep a notebook and write things down. But again, just to plug coaching, this is a great time for coaching, because when you go into a coaching session, it's like, this is time to unpack what's been kind of flipped around in your brain and say it out loud, try it on to hear your own voice speak what you're thinking. And it kind of like, once it comes out in the air or you even write it down, it's like then when you get to certain scripture or in your prayer time, it's like you're so much more sure, oh, well, that's what I was just talking about. It just really gives you that sense of assurance, instead of what happens often is thoughts kind of flit through our windshield, I say, and we just let them go by. We don't pull them in. We don't root down and really dig into the yes or no of it. But coaching can really help you by saying, well, what does your wife say about that? Well, what would happen if this happened and it was just what you said? How would you feel? Mm-hmm. And they can begin to unpack it in a way that really makes it real. And the request is real. So then when the answer comes, it feels like that's the answer. Mm-hmm. Roy, do you agree with that?
I think that's very true. And coaching definitely can help with that. And one of the things that, especially if someone's anticipating a transition, like they said, they're ready for it. I might want to spend a little time unpacking why. You know, why are you ready for this? And not just simply because they, you know, trying to get them to commit to staying or anything like that, but just to say, okay, do you have solid reason? You know, there, what is the Lord saying to you? Do you sense that this is the time that your ministry here is done? You know, so those kinds of things are important to unpack, especially with someone else. You know, as you're anticipating that, it's really critical. So that you're on that solid foundation that you were talking about, and that you understand exactly why you're going to do this, and you're going to anticipate it well.
And sometimes we think we're not running away from something or we're finished with something, but with an outside person, sometimes those questions can really help you just acknowledge truthfully. And that's not a yay or nay to making a transition, but sometimes to leave well, you may need to have some conversations that you have just kind of let stretch out. But that would be, if you're going to take all you can energy wise for this next pouring out period, let's just not leave anything kind of with the, you know, a heavy weight on us that's unfinished business. I think that's a key. Yeah.
Yeah. And even asking questions like, what would you do differently? Mm-hmm. You know, from the place where you've been, how are you going to do it differently going forward? And those kinds, along with all the other questions, can be
Yeah,
helpful, I think.
reflection is really key.
Yeah.
What are some of the other keys to handling transition well? What are some of the resources, just as being part of the body of Christ, what are some of the resources that the Lord has provided for us to be able to go through these changing seasons in our life with grace and with a graceful spirit?
Well, one thing that I have find myself bringing up always with a new coaching client, because we've got usually the big thing, whether it's a career change or relational change, but when you're in a transition, and so think about COVID, what did a lot of people do during that time? They cleaned their garage, they planted a garden, they repainted their house. They used that time where things were a little fuzzy. They could look back and go, well, at least I got that done. And I didn't have time for it before. Because remember, some parts of transition have a little bit of a lesser on-call thing because you're not fully engaged yet. So I love to work with a coaching client and say, so is there anything practical? Lots of times they'll say, oh, I want to reboot my, you know, my exercise program. They want to have something in that fuzzy time that's healthy and putting in some good ready to use resilience and something to show for that time, instead of just sitting on the couch going, I don't know what's happening in my life, and watching TV and just numbing down much, or ignoring their friends who are calling them to check on because they don't have answers to their questions. So I think during transition, it's important to have some practical goals. Like, I never saw so many of my neighbors, except during COVID, kids with bikes and parents out walking. They were using that time that they had to do something productive. And they could look back and say, wow, that was great. Remember how we, you know, we all learned how to play these games or whatever. So during transition, I think it's important to do the right thing for your body, for your social life, just really pour into things. It's kind of like, I don't know that, but I know this, and let's just do it. And coaches can help you by saying, okay, so when are you going to exercise? Well, I'll try to do more. I go, more doesn't work in coaching. We need something specific. Okay, 3 mornings a week. I go, how long? Well, 45 minutes. Okay, so let's do it. And let's check back in, because if that's not a sustainable goal, then you're not making a lifetime commitment right now, and we'll tweak it. So you can just coach yourself when down here. So I think practical, people sorting through tubs of paperwork, people rearranging their guest room to be in office. There's so many good things. And what people will say is, I felt so productive that I was ready to tackle some of that emotional stuff, which was a little bit harder. I just felt like I was really showing up in some areas. And so that made me feel a little bit more into that. I wasn't feeling like I'm such a, you know, I'm just such a slug or whatever. So practical as well as that. And a good place to then join an online Bible study, or if you can't find one where you're at, there's so many options, you know, to do that. So I like it when people have 3 or 4 overarching goals in a transition. They got the big one, but let's just check in. You said you haven't had a physical in 3 years. When are you going to do that? You mean like, you want me to tell you? I'm like, yes. When's your appointment? Let's get this done. And then the next time I'll say, did you do it? No. Well, when, you know, and sometimes my favorite thing, I don't know about you, Roy, but I'll say, so let's, you know, what progress did you make? Well, I just did such and such last night because I knew you were going to ask me. I'm like, don't care. Win-win. Yeah. You got it done. Yeah, and so I think that's really, I love to just be practical as well as spiritual and emotional while you're waiting for that, because God made us in all those ways. And to enjoy this life, there's beautiful things out there that sometimes don't have anything to do with your transition, but would refresh you and would just, again, have you notice that God is still here.
Mm-hmm.
But other resources, coaching, obviously we've talked about that. But I think when people are new in a town, there are amazing ways to find things. If you are in it, the first thing I did when I came, because I'm part of a 2 ladies groups that are philanthropic women's organizations, and they're international. So I transferred my membership, and they have to respond. So I got invitations to come, and yes, I was a stranger, but I did know the rhythm of the meetings. I knew we were learners, so we're going to have good speakers. I learned so much about Wichita from those groups. I had no idea. I mean, did you know that Pizza Hut started in Wichita? Yes, it did. Right on the campus of Wichita State. I just learned a lot about my town. But having that, and there are groups called meetup.com. There are Facebook groups that you could just plug in there what your interest is. And this is a way just to begin. And especially if you're a pastor or someone in a church and you don't want to just be kind of confined to the relationships in your church, it's great to know your community and have those other outlets. It's just a way to feel like I live here. And volunteer work. Sometimes you'll find something going on. I'm a reading buddy at a local elementary school. It takes 30 minutes once a week. They give me a kid. I show up. We read books together. I've had one from Tanzania. It's just been great. So I think are you hearing my theme? You have to initiate during transition. You want to be invited. And I hope every church does that to their pastor. But sometimes they invite you, but it's still not quite the sense of, I'll say we were invited to four small groups to tell our story and they prayed for us. And so this one lady asked me at the end of one of the meetings, we're having the meal together. She goes, well, has everybody been treating you well? And have you met people? I'm like, oh yeah, this is the fourth group we've visited, but no one's invited us to stay. My husband's like, oh my gosh, you did not just say that. I'm like, and she said, what? You're kidding. Well, I think everybody just thinks you're so busy. I'm like, we need relationships too. Well, then join our group. And we did. So I know that was bold, but she was so friendly. I felt like it would be okay with her. But my husband on the way home, well, you really handled that well. I'm like, I gotta have people. I don't have anybody.
You showed up as your full self and the Lord provided. I love that. I love that. I think so many of us are timid and we just want to play nice, but I love that the Lord gave you that courage to be honest about what your need was. And then he provided. That's amazing.
And it's interesting too, that we are in the age where some of those social media options can actually be healthy, although we all rail against all the unhealthy stuff, but those options are out there, right?
Yeah. This one coaching client I had, he was I know it makes me think about the old beatnik days, but he liked to do poetry readings. And there are actual places in Wichita. There's a Facebook group and they just do open mic with poetry reading. I didn't know. I mean, and he found it and they, yeah. And then actually later he was looking for a new job and it was somebody on that group that helped him find his new job. So you never know. I just think we have to step out in faith. If God indeed called us here and he's working all things out for our good in different areas, then let's just step into it. And it takes faith. And I worked with people with social phobias and all that. So there's ways to do things kind of slowly and easily. And sometimes with texting first and before you actually, meet someone. But in the world of online dating and all this other stuff, a lot of people, they do it all the time. So making friends or finding good places to do that. Yeah. With your kids. I mean, how do you find out if they want to take swimming lessons? You gotta find the information somehow. So.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's right. Well, Gail, if people are interested in learning more about your work or connecting with you, where can they find you online?
So I do have a contact page on my website, which is just gailgoolsby.com. But as you can tell, I do, a lot of people find me on Facebook and will just send a message or, just send a direct message. So I am kind of out there. I do some writing. So sometimes when people Google my name, some of those things come up, which I didn't really know that. My daughters told me that. I was like, oh yeah, that's me, huh? Anyway, so if it's that, but I also would be happy just to, they can go to the website and send a contact form and whatever they are looking for, I'll be happy to help. And there's a little bit on there about coaching or counseling and just different kinds of services because it is different. I love both of them. I'm probably more of a coach than a counselor in the sense that I'll go to the cognitive side. But I love to work with people who really want to unpack the past and get unstuck to move forward and enjoy their life better. And I've worked a lot with reentry people and people who have been in ministry are now shifting. Now retired people still feel like they're using the life that God gave them. So it's been great to see how A lot of people have really enjoyed their relationships and different things, because blank pages are kind of intimidating, but they're kind of fun. You know what Annie Green Gable said, you know, tomorrow's fresh with no mistakes in it yet. I mean, it's a new page. So let's.
Awesome. Yeah.
That's right. And even better if you have a coach to walk alongside you through it. So I'm grateful for that aspect of your ministry. I wanted to be sure to mention to folks that Gail has written a memoir on her experience in Afghanistan called Unveiled Truth. You can find that online if you Google her name, or if you go to her webpage, you'll also find the link there. One of our attendees tonight asked about how they can access the recording of this webinar. We will be emailing out the link to this recording once we have it uploaded to the EPC YouTube channel. So don't worry at all, you'll receive the link in your email. And you're welcome to send it with your friends if they would benefit from this time that we've had together. Also wanted to give you a quick reminder that our next webinar in this series will be on September 3rd. We're going to be talking with Fred Leon about preparing your heart and your head for retirement. So more conversation on transition and specifically drilling down on how we can be well prepared to navigate the transition into retirement well. Also want to give a shout out once again to PIR Ministries. You have their website there. I've put it in the chat, pirministries.org. And Roy, once again, thank you for co-hosting this series. It's just been a joy to get to do this together. And Gail, any last words from you tonight before we wrap up? Is there anything on your heart that you'd want to share with our viewers about walking with the Lord through transition?
You know, sometimes when you're a person like me and you kind of process quickly, or you land on a decision and you're not so quick to want to undo that, transitions can really rock your boat because there's just so much unknown about them. And so I remember when I was a school counselor and I was doing a career ed class, and I had a bulletin board that every year I put up, and it said, we can't know the future, but we can know God, who knows the future. And I feel like in transition, that's what we're banking on. Mm. He knows the future. And so all he's really saying is, just walk with me. I've got this. And there's going to be some ups and downs. I mean, you look at Jesus' life. He knew a lot about the future. And still, I mean, I think about these times, I'm going, why would he even go to that town knowing what was going to happen there? But there was so much to do and to see God in new ways. And I think in transition, part of what we experience is we get to know God in a new way. And I say it like this, coaching is, I always thought I had God in a pretty big box, and I'm curious, and I love to see all the, oh, you're like that. And now I have to keep getting a bigger box, because people will come in after coaching and I'll have thought, oh, we're going to talk about this some more. And they'll come in going, well, guess what happened? I called Uncle Jerry and he told me that, and I got my business and we're starting. And I'm like, wow. So I think in transition, whether you're forced into it or you're drawn into it, stay curious and stay open and look for God all the time in the small, beautiful fall leaf that splats on your windshield, or the neighbor who brings you cookies that, you know, you didn't expect. Just look for God and he'll show you, I'm here, I'm in it. And the beauty of a transition is you think, oh, I really experienced God when I was running that institute in China. How's he going to find me in my hometown back in this house I grew up in? I'm like, the setting is not the problem. God basically promises, I'm going to do my work in you. You want to be there and do it? Fine. You want to be married? Fine. You want to be there? It's not the setting. He doesn't lose us. And believe me, having been an East Coast girl moving to the Midwest, I often thought the grass might be hiding me. It's pretty hard to find some people in the Midwest with the grass. But God found me. And I think transitions are another way for him to say, let's be close. Stay close to me and we'll get there, and you will have a lot of knowns again. But right now, let's just spend time together. Let's work on these other parts of your life and be ready for what's coming ahead.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's wonderful. Thanks, Gail, so much. This has been great. Great time.
So to
all of you who have joined us, we hope that this has been an encouragement and a help to you. We trust it will. And we're going to close in prayer now. And you have all of the links and access to what we want to make sure you get. And then the recording will be posted very soon. So let's pray together. And again, thank you, Gail.
Thank you.
Father, thank you for this time together. We have it's been rich with wisdom and insight from experience that Gail has brought to us. And thank you for the good questions that have come, people who are curious about this very difficult aspect of our lives. And we know that sometimes transitions and change happen because we initiate, and a lot of times it's because it's what happens to us. But regardless, help us to inhabit the liminal space you give us, to be patient and to listen and to look for you, and that you will give us the path forward. And not only that, the changes you will make in us, which I think sometimes you're far more concerned about.
Yes.
So thank you, Father, for this time. And may those who have watched and will watch be blessed, encouraged, and helped. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you all, and God bless.
Amen.